Hello, today we're going to create this cool Chladni plate simulation in Blender. It's surprisingly simple and it's really easy to change the seed to get all kinds of cool patterns. This is made entirely with geometry nodes and more specifically the new simulation nodes branch. So let's get right into it. Now, as a kid, have you ever taken a rope and just done this? This is kind of how Chladni plates work in real life. If we take a look at these points along the rope right here, you can see that they're pretty much stationary. So it makes sense that if we had sand in this imaginary two-dimensional world, that the sand would kind of find itself accumulating on these points right here. Now we just replace our rope with a metal plate, and we replace our child with a speaker or some audio source. And the way that sound resonates through the plate will cause the sand to form these cool patterns in the places that are still. Now, what's the actual math for this kind of height map? Well, the equation is really simple. It's right here. So let's go ahead and do that first. I'm going to replace this plane with a grid. That makes it really easy to set a resolution here. I'm going to start with something like 100 maybe. If we had a set position node, by changing the C value, this can act as a height map. I'm going to add a vector math scale and plug that into the offset. And with this value right here, we can try adding a noise texture just to test. As this value right here increases, our noise acts as a height map. Another thing we can do, I'm not sure if it actually helps, but we can set this to shade smooth. Now let's plug in that equation that we looked at before. I'm going to create a new node group. This group is going to have a float for the output, which I'm going to name height. It'll have a vector input, and then four floats. These are going to be called n, m, a, and b. And these variables are the basis for our equation. Let's start by separating the x, y, and z, and I'm going to add a few math nodes. We are going to need a few multipliers and signs. And now we're just going to plug in X, Y, X, and Y into these multiply nodes. And we want to do N, M, and then M, and N. So what we're doing is multiplying every combination of X, Y, M, and M. After that, we have to multiply these together up here and do the same down here. And then we're going to multiply the top one with A and the bottom one with B. And the last step is to add these together. You could use an add node, but fewer nodes to just use the multiply add right here. And that's our entire height map. I'm going to call this Chladni. And if we plug that into our scale, nothing's happening. It's because a bunch of our values are 0. I'm going to set A and B to 1. Now as we change N and M, you'll see these patterns start to form. If it's a bit too extreme for you, you can change the scale node right here to make it easier to see. And this right here is like the three-dimensional form of our rope, where this is how the sound is resonating throughout this plate. Now, how do we drive a particle simulation with this height map? We're going to be using the new simulation nodes for this, and the particles aren't going to strictly move up and down, so we actually have to get the normal here. Another thing to note is that our plate, won't actually be displacing this much, obviously. Let's add a store named attribute node, and this is going to go before our set position. It'll be a vector. We'll plug position in, and let's call that pose for position. So we're storing the position of this flattened out plane right here before we actually apply that height map. After that, we want to store another named attribute. And this is going to be called nor for normal. And we'll plug the normals in right here. After that, if we add another set position and add another named attribute, this one will be pose. Our plane flattens out again because we're setting the position to what it was before we displaced it. If we go ahead and take a look at our nor attribute here, you can see that we have this normal though, kind of baked into an attribute. And this is going to drive our particle simulation. All right, now let's add our sand. For this, I'm going to add a mesh circle and set this to N-gon. And now I'm just going to add a distribute points on faces. You don't have to use a circle, you can use whatever you want. I'm going to set the radius to 0.5 and the density to something like 100,000. Now our points are way too big. I'm going to add a set point radius and lower it down to 0.001 maybe. Let's add a simulation output first, and then a simulation input. Now if your simulation nodes look a bit different, they don't have all the same stuff that mine do. That's because I'm using an older version of geometry nodes with this use cache option. If you don't have this, then you don't need to worry, everything's still the same. The only issue was that I didn't find a way to actually render the final animation without this option here. These are still in alpha, so things are subject to change, but the general idea should still be exactly the same. The way these work is, on the very first frame we're going to use this geometry here, and then after that each frame is going to take whatever we plug in here and feed that back out here. This essentially lets us buffer information or read and write to memory, and this is what allows custom simulations to work. If we set x to say 0.1 and then hit play, you'll see that it moves 0.1 units every single frame, even though this value right here isn't changing at all. So instead of adding a constant value to our simulation, let's try adding that normal. If we try just using a named attribute like this, it won't actually do anything, and that's because this normal is only being stored on our grid over here. We want our simulation to use that normal attribute. We're going to add a sample nearest surface node, set this to vector, and then plug in this value here. We plug that into offset, everything kind of explodes, but this is going to let our particles look at the normal on the closest surface point. Now, why does everything explode? First, let's scale this z value by 0. We'll worry about the height later. For now, we just want to look at it in two dimensions. Now, the issue here is that our particles are moving way too far each frame. It would be like if your volume on your speaker is turned up too high, so instead of the sand accumulating in these nice patterns, it's just getting blasted all over the place. We can fix that with a scale node right here, and changing this to a smaller value, like say 0.05. You can see that these patterns are already starting to accumulate. Now if we think back to our rope example, our rope isn't just static, it's constantly changing. Our height map is doing that too. In order to represent that, we'd have to switch between using a negative value and a positive value for this scale, but it doesn't actually look pretty good. And the reason for that is because if we imagine our two-dimensional world, all of our sand falling on a rope isn't going to hit the rope at the same time, especially if our rope is vibrating too fast for the human eye to see. So we know that when the sand hits our metal plate, it'll be at some point between 1 and negative 1, if we imagine multiplying that onto our height map. So to account for that, I'm going to add a random value and a multiply node, and I'm going to multiply that scalar that we had before, 0.05. I'm going to multiply that with a random value between negative 1 and 1. What you'll see now is that our patterns are looking symmetrical and how they should be, but our particles still aren't moving randomly enough. You can see once they kind of start heading in a direction, they don't stop, and that's because this random scale that we're applying would change every single frame. So I'm just going to add a scene time node with frame and plug that into the seed here. And now our simulation is technically done, but there are a few issues that we have to figure out. One is that once the sand hits the edge of our plate, it kind of just stretches off into infinity. We can solve that by increasing the size of our grid to 2, for example. And now that's looking fine. Another thing is that this has no height to it. Now, if we're rendering, we definitely want some height because that makes the shadows and reflections and all that look much better. Now, rather than trying to figure out gravity and all these different things, we're just gonna fake it. Let's add a set position after our simulation, and we can control the height with this Z value right here. We know that if a particle is moving fast, it'll probably be up in the air. And if it's stationary, then it's probably settled into one of these patterns. So how do we get the speed of each particle? Well, this vector that we're adding to their position each frame is actually their velocity. And just getting the length of this gives us our speed. We can plug that into a vector mass scale. And let's plug that into offset. And by increasing the Z value, you can see that this works surprisingly well for a height map. It's best to keep this pretty subtle, just strong enough to give this some depth without being too overdone, and it is pretty easy to overdo it. I usually leave it at like 0.2 to 0.4. I'm going to organize all of this a bit. If we want to change the seed on each frame and change up the pattern, we could animate these values, but I find that a really easy way to do it is to just kind of randomize them each frame. We could add 4 of these random values, but I find it a bit cleaner to just use a vector and then separate the XYZ. So this is the same as just 4 random values. Now, this just requires a bit of experimentation. It depends on your scene and the scale of everything. But I'm going to set the first 2 in this vector, which correspond to N and M. I'm going to make those somewhere between 5 and 20. And then A and B, I want to be somewhere between 0.25 and 1. Now you might notice that all of our patterns look wrong. They're totally random and messed up. That's because all of our particles are using different values for all of these variables when they should all be using the same constant values. To fix this, we can just add an integer here for ID, and make sure that the ID for both of these is always 0. After that, we can add a seed here. Now as we change the seed, we'll get different patterns. Just play around with these values until you find something that looks good, and you'll get all kinds of cool intricate patterns. If you want this to change every couple of seconds, we can add a scene time and let snap seconds to 2, which this is like the interval. If it's 2, then it means it'll change every 2 seconds. And we'll just plug that into the seed. And now you can see that our simulation is changing patterns every couple of seconds. Now there are a couple of rendering tricks that you want to use, some shading tricks if you do plan on rendering out this animation. I'm going to start by setting up a basic scene with a plane and some lighting. I'm going to make the world shader almost completely black. And I really like to use this kind of lighting here with an area light. I feel like it does a good job at showing the depth of our sand. We can see all these shadows from the patterns where they're higher up. Let's give our plane a darker material. I'm going to make it a bit more metallic. Maybe increase the roughness a bit. And then our sand, we're gonna give it a more golden material. Now you might notice that as you change the color here, nothing's gonna change. We do have to set our material over here in the geometry nodes. I like to bump up the metallic. I left roughness at about 0.5. I feel like that's the sweet spot. But there is a bit of an issue with this. I'm gonna increase the strength of this area light. In my opinion, the shading across all of the particles is much too uniform, so there's 2 things that we're going to do about this. The first one is to add a random value over here in our sand frame, and just randomize the radii. So I'll go somewhere between like 0.0005 and 0.001. I find that this variation helps quite a bit. The other thing that we're going to do for the variation is to store named attribute. It'll be a vector, and this will just be a random value. I'm going to call it rand. It'll be between negative 1 and 1. And if we go into our shader and add a new attribute, and we type in rand, you'll see that we can now get this random vector here, add a geometry node, and mix this with our random vector. Now where this factor is 0, we're going to use our original normals, and where it's 1, we're going to use these totally random vectors. I find that using completely random stuff is a bit too varied, something like 0.5. And this kind of makes more sense with how sand is in real life. It's much more angular and rocky, it's not perfectly round spheres, so you kind of get these glints of light. We still want to use cycles point rendering because it's super fast. Our sand is looking a lot better, but there's still one more thing we can do to make it look even better, and that's to go into our plane material and add an ambient occlusion node and a color ramp. I'm going to use this gray material here, and then we're going to use the sand color over here. You'll see that that creates this kind of glow. We plug that into our material. I think it almost looks like a finer grain dust. We can also plug this AO into metallic and specular, and there you go. Now you just have to add depth of field, motion blur, stuff like that. Motion blur is one of the big ones. I set my shutter speed to something like 0.8. It really helps a lot when you can see the streaking motion of the particles rather than all these little dots. Now with some compositing and color correction and all that, you can get something that looks a bit like this.